And welcome to Christian Fellowship. I want to thank you for being here today, as well as welcome those who are joining us online. I'm glad you could be with us. You know, again, I shared a story last week about someone who's been joining us online, and we prayed for him, and that conversation has just continued with this fellow. So it's just really cool, folks, how we're able through computer and internet to continue to reach out to folks really literally all around the world. So this morning, we're going to spend some time in worship. We've really got a full day today. We're going to have graduate recognition. We've got a couple of graduates this morning, and then we're going to do a missions update. One of the things that we want you to know, we've been speaking for the last 5 weeks about outreach, about missions, whether it's across the street or across the globe, it's still about outreach. So we've been talking about that. And then we've got guest speakers here this morning. Mark and Melody Weaver are going to come and share with us. So we've got a lot going on this morning. But before we get started, I want us to just take a deep breath. Everybody with me, take a deep breath. It's summertime. It's summertime. Hallelujah. And we've had inches and inches and inches of rain. I don't believe we need to make a boat yet, but it's summertime. And our drummer is gone, and a vocalist is gone, and our video people are gone, and you know what? It's still summer. And God is still on the throne. Amen? Let me read you a definition of worship. Worship is a noun. So it's a thing. It's a person, place, or thing. Worship is a noun. Worship is a thing. Get a hold of that. It's a thing. It is a feeling or an expression of reverence and adoration for deity. Quote unquote, the worship of God. It's a feeling, okay, I get that. But sometimes you have to allow yourself, or for David spoke to himself. He said, "Rise up, O my soul." He told himself, "Get up." Have you ever had somebody in your life that you just felt like, you know, somebody ought to just give them a kick in the pants so they get out of bed in the morning? You ever had that person? How often has that person been you? Where you're like, you know what, I really need to just get up and do this. Well, this morning, we're missing a drummer. I want to show you that we all are drummers. Okay, these are sticks.
Tracy is going to be up here, and she's going to go one, two, three, four, right? She's going to do it. She's going to do it. And every time she does that, I want you to respond. You're the drummer. You get to keep beat, and you can even do something really snappy if you want to. You can do if you want. But we all, this is worship, folks. This is worship. Ron wants to say something.
I just need to stick and drum if I want to be the drummer.
So let's open with a word of prayer this morning. And I'm going to ask you to stand with us and worship the Lord. It is a noun. Tell yourself to rise up and to worship. This is about us standing up and worshiping the Lord. Father, I thank you for your goodness towards us. I thank you for your life. God, David spoke to his own soul and he said, "Rise up, O my soul." And this morning, we need to rise up and we need to worship you this morning. Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for the sunshine. We thank you for the rain. We thank you for the air that we breathe. We thank you for the clothes that we wear. We thank you for a roof over our head. If you get the point, we need to thank God for a few things this morning. God, we give you thanks. We give you praise. We give you worship. We give you our hearts, God. We ask you this morning, Father, to receive our worship. It's our goal. It's our desire to show you this morning how much we love you, and we adore you, and we worship you. In Jesus' name. Amen? Amen.
All right, we're going to sing about the whole earth is full of his glory. You are the hope. living in us, and you truly are the God in whom we trust. Our hope is in you. You are the hope of the world. Thank you. greet someone this morning and have a seat.
If we could have our ushers come forward, we will receive our morning offering in just a moment. I just want to say again, thank you so much for your faithful giving. Congregation has been givers, and God has just honored that in this body. So I just want to again say thank you so much for your giving. As you give towards the needs and the ministries of the church, God meets those needs according to his riches and glory. And I believe that he'll meet those needs in your life as well as we continue to give. So let's pray over this offering this morning. Father, we just thank you so much for your goodness. We thank you for your life. We thank you for your provision. God, I thank you for your abundance. You've given us an abundance of peace. An abundance of joy. Your word says that we have enough life that we can give it away. So God, I pray that we would just experience that on a regular basis. I thank you for each person here today, God. And I thank you for those who are watching us online. I pray that as we give, God, that you would pour back into our hearts and our lives. And we just thank you for that according to your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. A couple of announcements this morning. If you can't smell it, we're having pot blessing after church. So if you came and you said, you know, I really didn't prepare for that, I'm going to ask you to just hang around anyhow. It'd be a good time to fellowship and spend some time together. So pot blessing right after church. We have graduate recognition Sunday this morning. We have a couple of graduates. Also, tonight I will be speaking out at the Cowboy Church. We had Pastor Brian shared here when we were in Haiti. And so now it's my turn to return that favor. So he's asked me if I would share out there. Also, actually, I'll be speaking. It's kind of like sharing and speaking all at the same time. I will be sharing and or speaking at Strawberry Lake Christian Retreat on Wednesday night this week. So give you an opportunity for those of you who haven't been out to Strawberry Lake. This is the first week of their services. So come on out and enjoy that. A couple things going on the back side of the bulletin. There's Monday night, we have a prayer meeting. Folks, we get together and spend time praying as well as we're going through the book of Acts, kind of verse by verse, word by word. I want to encourage you to come out and be a part of that. Also, Monday night is our missions committee meeting. Friday, June 12th, we have a corporate prayer and worship time here. A couple of things that are going on this summer. We've got the 2015 Bible Reading Marathon from June 27th through July 3rd, DL City Park. Barry still needs readers, I'm sure. So be a part of that. Also, feeding the 5,000 just the week before. I'm telling you, this is kind of an exciting thing. Can you imagine? Out in our parking lot, we are going to feed 5,000 people. We don't know who those people are yet. But we're getting the food and getting the preparations. You're going to hear a little bit about that. But I believe we're going to do it. I believe we're going to do it. We're actually going to get a radio spot, and we're going to challenge people in our community to come and help us meet this goal. That's something that God has put on Ron's heart, and I just believe that's what we need to be doing. Okay, moving right along. There are also a couple of other things in there. Keep your bulletins handy. Read them. Take a look at them. See what's going on. This morning, I'm going to ask Madison Fagley and Miranda Puttbreeze to come forward as two graduates of the class of 2015. Give them a hand. Yay! Come on up. You don't get to stand down there. Now, I've asked them to do something a little different that I haven't asked any other graduates to do before, but they're going to tell you a little bit about their life story and what their plans are for... No, not that far. Maybe not your whole life story. Yeah, okay. Just thought I'd see if I could make one of them pass out, you know. But actually, I want them to share with you what their plans are for the future. We often, kids graduate, and we don't really think a whole lot about what they have been thinking about. They've been planning, and they've been hoping, and they've been dreaming for things. And so I just have asked them both to share just a little bit about what they're planning on here after graduation. So, Maddie?
I already graduated, never mind. But I'm planning on going to YWAM in January, so.
And what is YWAM?
Youth with a Mission.
Okay. And where are you going?
Hawaii. Well, for the DTS, which is like the training. So I'll go to Hawaii for 3 months and like learn how to like be best used or whatever, like in another country, so I'll be prepared. But.
And where are you going after that?
I don't know.
She doesn't know yet. She goes to YWAM to Hawaii for 3 months, right? Mm-hmm. And then she doesn't know where she's going.
Yeah.
And how long are you going there?
Well, I'll be in the other country for 3 months. So, yeah.
And Miranda?
Well, my plans are just to go to M State here in town and do my generals, and then eventually I want to go into criminal law, but I haven't really got any further than that.
So, a question for you. You're not talking this morning, are you? Criminal law, you're not? No. Let's give her a hand.
I know we're going to pray for these young ladies. You know what? We set our plans and God sets our future. So I want to encourage you to be open to what God speaks to you through the course of the summer and even as you go. I was planning on being a mechanic and then that turned into an electrician and somewhere along the way, here's what you got. But trust God through it all. That's what I'm saying. Let's stretch out our hands and let's pray for them. Father, I just thank you so much for Maddie and for Miranda. God, your plans for them far supersede what their own plans are. You, God, have these two young ladies in the palm of your hand, and God, I pray that you would continue to work in their lives. I thank you for hearts that are open. I pray that you'd continue to minister not only to them, but through them. Lord, I pray that you'd use them in days and weeks and months and years to come. Lord, we pray for safety for them. Both of them are going into uncertain places. If Miranda goes into law enforcement or criminal justice and Maddie goes overseas, God, I pray for your hand of protection over them. I pray that you would send angels to go before them and then be their rear guard as well. God, that you would truly show yourself in their lives. Thank you so much for these young ladies. God, I pray that you would just bless them and that you would pour your goodness out towards them and that they would experience you. God, that they would really experience you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And before you go on your way, Maddie, here's your Bible. Miranda, God bless you. Use those as swords. It's really a good thing to do. Amen? Bless you. Thank you. Tracy has an announcement that she's going to make.
Last fall in October, 10 of us went to a women's retreat. Bridging the Gap is the organization, and it was in at Lake Geneva in Alexandria this year. It's also going to be in October, October 9th and 10th. It starts at noon on Friday the 9th and just goes through Saturday afternoon, so just 2 hours away. It's in St. Cloud this year, and just over one night. But I would just encourage, I'm going to be kind of helping coordinate it. It's not going to be real tough because we don't have to have like a certain number. Basically, how I'm going to do it is as soon as you let me know and pay your ticket, I will get your ticket for you and arrange the lodging. It's going to be real different as far as the facilities. It's going to be at the St. Cloud Convention Center. And what it'd be good to do is if you know you're going to go, just take care of it as soon as you can, because the Best Western is connected and they've given discounted rates, but it's only a certain block of rooms. So it could be that they'll sell out and then we'd have to find a different place. But the cost of the tickets are early bird. So if you pay by the end of July, it's $50. Single moms, students, which would be up to 25 years old, or military, the ticket is $40. Otherwise, like there at the time, it's $80. So that's a good savings. Lodging will be $100 a room. The rooms are very nice. It's a Best Western. You can actually go to their website and see the speakers, and it's got connections to the motels and everything. The site is Minnesota Bridging the Gap, and it's just MNBTG for Bridging the Gap .org. And so go on that site, because that's, I finally got around to checking it out last week and I really got inspired. Last year I went just to fellowship with our ladies, knowing that it'd be good. And it was well beyond. They have a huge worship band that does the worship. The speakers are top notch. And one of the things that I was just really blown away and really inspired by is seeing all of the women in this area, in Minnesota, in our local area, that are just totally in love with the Lord and inspirational and talented. And so that was really just encouraging too, to just be kind of rubbing shoulders outside of our, you know, four walls and our small town. And so anyway, let me know if you're interested in going.
And what she didn't say, she kind of said, was you can book room together, so that $100 can turn into $50, or it can turn into $30 or $25 even. So boy, it can be really, really reasonable. And I think we're going to have the ladies preach that Sunday after they get back, because I think that's good. Lonnie, come and share with us. We are going to be doing a missions update on a regular basis. This is something new for us, and take over.
Okay, here we go. I'm Lonnie. I'm on the missions committee. Our team leader, our missions leader, is Kim Ramsey. On the committee is Pastor Tim, myself, and Linda Prine, Mallory Huddlestead, Maddie Fagley, Jenna Sieberg, and Crystal Castle. And hopefully you'll be hearing from them this summer with different missions updates. We don't just concentrate on overseas missions. We're also concentrating on local things, like Pastor talked about, the Feeding the 5,000 out here. We need volunteers for that. So if you have any time at all, that's happening on June 22nd through the 27th. And so consider that. Helping out is going to be right here. So that's part of our local mission.
What are the hours that you're going to be serving?
I'm not sure what. 10 a.m. to 8 p.m. And so, yes, thank you very much, and encourage your neighbors to come. Up in Fargo, we are working with a homeless shelter, so a local outreach. Also sending some monthly support, our churches, up to the Christian Retreat Camp up here at Strawberry Lake. But we also are working on overseas with Haiti. Pastor Leslie, we've been working with him for, I've been working with him for 12, 13 years, something like that. And this last spring, or last winter, February, we had a team go over to Haiti, and they spent time with Pastor Leslie and another pastor. And I've got a little bit of information on those two pastors that I'd like to read here. Pastor Leslie Bertrand, founder and bishop of Grace Assembly Network in Haiti, stands with his wife, Bernadette, for the cause of Christ in Haiti. He's a pastor of Grace Assembly's family of churches. Overall, he is overseeing 27 congregations in different areas in Haiti. Grace Assembly Network is a non-denominational family church. They focus on evangelism, discipleship, and equipping leaders. All these emphasis are on growth and a vibrant network of churches. Ministry is challenging in a country hampered with extreme poverty and political instability. Pastor Leslie believes that education and leadership and development are key components for the future of the church in Haiti. Assembly de la Grace, the Mother Church of Grace Assemblies Networks, GAN, was founded by Pastor Leslie in 1979. He first ordained as a Mennonite pastor to the Sunlight Missions in Haiti. He received a biblical education through their extension program. He then began planting churches in the rural mountains and in the area of Haiti before being called to establish a network of churches in Port-au-Cay, which is near Port-au-Prince. Through years of aiming at growth and leadership training, 2008, Pastor Leslie was overseer of 24 congregations, one orphanage, and seven schools. I got to spend quite a bit of time with Pastor Leslie when he was here. He spoke here. Anyway, during this time, we talked about a lot of stuff, but I asked him, I said, how are you being supported? What, you know, who pays your salary, whatever? And he says, I don't get a salary, I live by faith. He says he has a friend that sends him $50, I believe it's a month, and another friend that sends him $200 every 3 months. So he doesn't get much money. And so we, as a missions team and leadership of the church, have decided to support Pastor Leslie for $100 a month. While the team was over there, they met another pastor, Pastor Roosevelt. I'd never met him when I was over there, but the team met him, and Pastor Leslie asked if we would consider supporting him. Well, the team members, they liked him a lot. Got a little information on him. Pastor Roosevelt is married with four kids, been in training with Pastor Leslie to pastor a church. Living in Port-au-Prince and has recently began commuting 1 hour, two times a week, to one of Pastor Leslie's churches. He has no personal transportation, he either walks or pays for a taxi. He has been asked by Pastor Leslie to reside over this rural church, so he is sacrificing time with his family to do what he feels he's called to do. So we've also decided to sponsor him for $100 a month, because I don't know if he's getting anything at all. So anyway, so these two pastors we are going to be supporting for each $100 a month. Now, we have so far raised $10,200 for our missions in Haiti out of a possible $75,000 that we're hoping for. So keep that in mind. The Feed the 5,000 program out here was $20,000, and so far we have raised $6,800 for that. So thank God for what he's given us, and thank God for what he's going to be giving us. So keep that in mind. I know people have been donating vehicles, they've been donating large items to be auctioned off. Pastor Tim has a place where you can auction things off. And so if you have large items you want to donate towards Haiti stuff, which is a great thing to do, do that. A few other things the missions committee's been working on is we want to put up a missions wall out here in the entryway. Just so that you guys all know what we're doing. So that's all out there. We talked about training for new missionaries, and for everybody that wants to go through that stuff, you'll be hearing more about that. We want to be doing fundraisers, and if you have any questions, talk to Pastor Tim, myself. Kim Ramsey is our leader for the missions committee. That is your June missions update.
Amen. Amen. Stuff goes on in the church sometimes, you don't know what's going on. We want you to know what's going on. We want you to know that it's our goal. I believe as we left Haiti this time, I've shared this with you, that I sat at my desk here trying to determine where do we spend, what do we do first? How do we help these people first? And of the projects that I believe God laid on my heart as I was praying about it, I asked the Lord, well, what do we do first? What do we do second? What do we do third? And I just felt like the Lord told me, just plan on doing them. And so I started adding it all up, and I said, God, that's $75,000. As I was walking through Walmart, I told the Lord, I said, this means I have to raise $75,000. Lord, that's $8,000 a month for 10 months. And I got by the ice cream aisle and I said, I got real spiritual then by the ice cream. And I said, Lord, this is, okay, it's $8,000 a month for the next 10 months that we need to raise. I went from me to we. And by the time I got to the coffee aisle, I felt as though the Lord spoke to me and said, I don't need you to raise anything. I just need you to be a faithful steward. And so as God puts on your heart what to give towards these things, and not just you, I believe God's going to use people in our community. I believe he's going to use people around our nation to give in ways that we can't even begin to fathom. So be praying with us and trusting for $75,000. That's all. That's not that big of a deal for a God who created the universe, is it? I don't think so. Amen. We're going to have Mark and Melody come up this morning and share with us. Mark and Melody, we had a video that is non-functional. We've out-technologied ourselves. I apologize for that. Please come on forward, Mark and Melody Weaver. And or just Mark, okay. He's going to share with us this morning. And he has become a friend of Barry Schroeder's over the past weeks, months, and years, I guess. And so, I'm pretty laid back here. We just have a moving pulpit. So I want to just pray for you and pray with you here. And Father, I just thank you for Mark and for his heart towards missions, his heart towards the video that they take out across the world and to share the gospel and the story of Jesus. And God, I pray right now that you would just anoint Mark. And I thank you for him. And God, I ask you to just bless him and help his words to open our hearts to what you're doing around the world. Thank you for your goodness towards us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Bless you, amen. Mark. Thank you, Tim. Good morning. It's good to be with you here in Detroit Lakes. Hey, Melody will be up later. She closes it out because I always give Melody, my wife, the last word. So, congratulations again to Miranda and Maddie, wherever she is. It excites me to see young people launching out to serve God. And one of the reasons it excites me is I know what God did with a train wreck like me. I was a hippie. Now I'm a pastor. I met Jesus. He changed my life forever. So pray for a vision, because the Lord's vision for your life and his purpose goes exceeding abundantly beyond all we can ask or think. So fasten your seat belts. It's an exciting ride. Had to do that. I was a youth pastor a long time ago, and I love youth. They're just exciting. As Pastor Tim announced, Melody and I work for the Jesus Film Project. How many have heard about that? Know something about it? Okay, this is a missions-minded church, I can tell. That's exciting. The church I was pastor at in California, when we had missionaries come, we'd say, we want to hear about your mission, what's going on out there, but we also want a teaching from God's Word for our people on Sunday morning. So I've kind of followed that protocol, if you will, as we go on the road. And so you're going to get a little teaching of God's Word, and you're also going to hear about some exciting things that God's doing out there in the world that you'll never hear on the 6 o'clock news, okay? It's a whole different world when you put God in the equation. Let's see. My purpose this morning, I want to encourage you folks in personal evangelism, reaching people for Christ, because every believer has a role to play in leading unbelievers toward heaven. And so that's kind of my purpose this morning. Let me start by asking a question. This Bible's loaded with a lot of notes. Okay, what's the theme of this book, cover to cover? The theme of the Bible. Jesus love for people. Salvation, I heard. from God's word to Adam in the garden, Genesis chapter 3, Adam, where are you? To the last invitation in the book, in the last chapter of the book, Revelation 22, and the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him who hears say, come. Let him who thirsts come. Whoever desires, let him take of the water of life freely. And so from Genesis to Revelation, the theme of this book is God's desire and passion to have restored fellowship and relationship with his people. So that there's the overall theme right there. You might be thinking, well, Pastor Mark, you're probably going to teach us on the Great Commission. And I'm not. You've probably heard sermons on it. Maybe Pastor Tim's preached sermons on it. You've probably heard the cliches that pastors use. It's not the Great Omission. It's not the Great Suggestion. Anyway, I'm not going to go there. I want to go to the words of the Apostle Paul in the book of 1 Corinthians. And we'll be starting in chapter 3, beginning with verse 5 through 8. That's 1 Corinthians 3, 5 through 8. And let's just read that. He gives some instruction here. And verse 5, he says, Paul says, who then is Paul? Who is Apollos? But ministers through whom you believed, as the Lord gave each one. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then, neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. Now, he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. Well, let's do a few observations here about this little short passage. Did you notice God gave three times in this little short passage? It's all about God. God gives us the gifts, the abilities, the opportunities, the whole enchilada, basically. And so God gives salvation of a soul. It's God's responsibility, right? But God employs or uses people in the process. And so some plant and some water. But God uses our participation. This is talking about rewards. Well, question. Are believers going to face judgment someday? Is that a trick question? Technically, yes. 1 Corinthians 3, 2 Corinthians 5 talk about the Bema seat, the judgment seat of Christ. And that's where believers will face judgment. Not for heaven and hell. That's decided in this life. But it's the judgment. And I like to think of it as a rewards banquet. What did you do with the resources and the time, and the spiritual gifts, and the opportunities I gave you? And so I see it as a positive thing. A rewards banquet. And then I need to ask a question. How many here say, well, Pastor Mark, I'm pretty sure, or I know for sure, I do not have the gift of evangelism. Let me see your hands, okay? You don't, that's not you. Most churches, a lot of hands go up, okay? So I'm going to give you a disclaimer and a relief right now, okay? Those of you who do not have the gift of evangelism, you do not have to preach at a Billy Graham crusade. You don't have to preach at a harvest crusade with Greg Laurie. We'll leave that to the evangelists, okay? But we can plant and we can water. right? Just because we don't have the gift of evangelism doesn't mean we can't be involved in the process. Your pot blessing, which we've been invited to, and praise God for church potlucks. They're wonderful. We're going to join you in that. And, you know, at that, I don't have the gift of service, acts of service, you know, fixing things and all this kind of stuff. I know I don't have that gift. But if I'm at your pot blessing and the trash is overflowing, there's a carton of trash can liners, and I look outside and there's the trash can, the bin, I'm going to empty the trash. Just because I don't have the gift doesn't mean I can't do acts of service. So, doesn't let us off the hook for being involved in leading people to Christ. The gospel. That's the good news. We've all heard that. Well, I like the Apostle Paul's definition of the gospel in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I think it's the best definition in the New Testament. And in chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians, starting with verse 3, "For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures." There's the gospel, right? In two verses. And maybe you're thinking, well, I believe that. I've always known that. Yeah, I agree. But then, do you know for sure you're going to heaven? For sure. I'm talking 100%. Okay? Well, I'd ask you, well, did you meet the one requirement Jesus laid down in John chapter 3? To one of the most religious men in Israel, he said with a double emphasis in the original language. Your Bible probably reads, most assuredly, truly, truly, or verily, verily. In the Greek, it's amen, amen. Jesus is saying, don't miss this point. It's too important. And he says, unless anyone, not just the guy he was talking to, Nicodemus, Nick at night, he says, unless anyone is born again, he cannot see or perceive the kingdom of God. Then you go down to verse 5, and he says, with another double emphasis there, unless one is born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. And we're all about, you know, we want to end up there. And then in verse 7, he says, do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. It's an absolute, guys. So what does it mean? Well, it's a spiritual rebirth. The Apostle Paul, remember, he said, you who were dead in your sins and trespasses are now made alive through the gospel. It's a spiritual rebirth. We're all born physically once, but a spiritual rebirth is where we invite the Lord in. We begin relationship with him. Not religion, but it's relationship. And our spirit comes alive. I did that, and I opened this book. Ah, it makes sense now. My spirit's alive, okay? So that's all important, as Jesus pointed out with a double emphasis. Okay, well, none of us are the Apostle Paul, but we're not a Billy Graham or a Greg Laurie, but we can plant and we can water. Amen? Okay, we're all qualified. Now, I wanted to focus on this verb here. Paul says, I delivered to you. That word delivered can also be translated transmit. So if we know what the gospel is, I'm a sinner, you need Jesus, he cleans you up, he saves your soul, you get born again. We understand that. Then all we have to do is transmit that to others who don't yet know that or understand that. Their receiver's not on yet, and they need a little help with understanding this concept. Okay, how many know somebody doesn't know Jesus, maybe you don't know how to approach him, you care about him, or you've tried to approach him and you haven't had great success. Anybody out there? We all, look at all the hands going up. I want to encourage you, nothing great happens without first prayer involved in the process. Don't give up. Pray for those people. I was the first believer in my family. And I prayed for my family, of course, because I had a heart. They need Jesus. I want them in heaven with me. I don't have time this morning to tell you of the revival I've seen in my family across the board. Wow. So never give up praying for people who need the Lord. I want to encourage you in this area. Say something. Be bold. Speak the word. Say something. Or ask strategic questions because it gets people thinking. It worked with me. At my first job, I'm cooking hamburgers at Carl's Jr. I think you folks call them Hardee's back here. And I'm closing cooking waitress, and this little waitress is working on me. And over 40 years later, I can still remember two things that were said that night. She's witnessing to me. I said, "Hey, I believe in God." I did. I said my prayers at night. I wasn't an atheist, right? And she shoots back, this little girl that became a very good friend of mine for many years, she shoots back with, "So what? So does Satan." Ooh, direct hit, right? 30 years later, when I'm preaching in James, "You believe in one God, you do well, even the demons believe and tremble," it hit me. Oh my gosh. "So what? So does Satan." Those five paraphrased words weren't even in the original text. Just the concept. That's how powerful God's word is. It was a bullseye that got me started on my spiritual journey. She was there as a friend to answer my questions, and it worked. Praise God. So don't be afraid of that. You know, now I was really shook up. I didn't show it because I was a teenager, and teenagers have to be cool. Amen, Miranda? But inside, whoa, I knew this gal had something I didn't have, you know? And it rocked my boat. And that's okay. That's a good thing because too many people in our culture are too complacent already, aren't they? Okay, another encouragement here. God encourages us in this process. Melody and I, for years, I used to be involved and lead a beach and street evangelism group in Southern California, and we got a hold of 10 or 12 cases of Harvest Crusade invitations that we'd hand out on the beaches. Well, Melody's at lunch one day, and she went down to the beach to hand some out. She walks up to this guy and says, "I guess you don't need one of these, huh? It was Greg Laurie who does the Harvest Crusades." And it's funny because that night on the radio, he said, "Hey, I got this invitation to Harvest from a lady on the beach today. I think I'm going to go." But we handed these out. And one night we're leaving Angel Stadium. I don't know what the seating capacity is there. They expanded it. It's probably 50,000 or more. And we're leaving this massive stadium, and Melody hears her name. And this girl comes up, one of the girls she handed an invitation to on the beach. And out of that whole stadium, she called her name. God encourages us, doesn't he? You know, when you're got a heart to reach somebody for Jesus, oh, that's at the center of God's will. Remember the theme of the whole book. So, God encourages us. I was preaching a message years ago. I don't remember what the message was, but I did a kind of an evangelistic application. I said, hey, I witnessed the telemarketers. You want to get them off the phone quick? But you got to be bottom line because they don't have much time, neither do you. And hey, can I ask you a question? Oh, yeah, anything. Do you know Jesus Christ is your personal Lord and Savior? You know, so I said, try that. Well, this family of five homeschooled kids, next week came in and they said, Pastor Mark, that works. Somebody from India called our house. We shared the gospel and they prayed on the telephone to receive Jesus. Yes. This stuff works. The senior pastor, I was assistant pastor at this church in California. Guess how he got saved? Somebody left a track in a phone booth. And he read it, and he prayed and received the Jesus. And for over 35 years, God's been using him, raised up a pastor, to reach the world through our missionaries. It's a great church. And somebody who left that had no clue. Think about it. We know that verse in Isaiah. God's word doesn't come back, what? Void or empty, right? It's going to accomplish the purpose he has. So, just sow the seed, like the Apostle Paul says. Okay, let me ask you this. I know the answer. You do too. Does God answer prayer? Yes. Can God answer prayers creatively? Maybe more than we could ask or think? I'm a staff, the assistant pastor, and pray for your pastor. It's a 24/7 responsibility. It's a heavy job. And I'm praying, Lord, I know everybody in the church is probably saved. I want to reach unbelievers. Here I am. Use me. I prayed that prayer. Well, and I said, Lord, you know my schedule. And our telephone at home starts ringing between 11 o'clock and 4 in the morning. Well, our phone number in Orange County was, after the prefix, 888-5959. It's a number I'll remember forever. Well, many 888 numbers, you know, they use them for toll-free. Well, if you were in our area, in my area code, and you missed the one for the toll-free number and dialed 888-5959, whatever the other three numbers were, doesn't matter because you get your local pastor instead of the Fox pay-per-view porn channel to order pornographic movies. So when I discovered this, I moved the phone over from Melody's side. I got a notepad, scriptures, a flashlight. I didn't even have to get out of bed to fulfill this answered prayer, right? And Melody's patient. Weekends were busier than weekdays and or weeknights. The guys at church called it my midnight ministry. And so I got a little script up. You know, I wanted to sound professional. I mean, it's a fireman ministry. You're asleep. Ring, bam, you're on, you know? It's like, wow. And so I got this script up, your phone number with area code, please. And most people would give it to me in case I needed a follow-up or something. And I said, are you calling for spies? Yes. Okay, I need to read you a disclaimer. Can you hear me okay? Yeah. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you should abstain from sexual immorality. 6 months I had this privilege of this ministry. Couple times around 4 in the morning, I led college students to the Lord. I remember this one teenager at a party. You could tell in the background something was going on. And he was kind of antagonistic. And what are you telling me, man? Everybody's telling me that. I said, don't you get it, man? God loves you. He's trying to reach you. And we're having this conversation, and all of a sudden, he's quiet. He says, I'm hanging up. I said, why? He said, you hit home, okay? I said, all right, have a good night. I'm going back to sleep. Anyway, God can be so creative with us. He wants to use us and involve us in the process. Okay, you're saying, well, Pastor Mark, tell us something about the Jesus film. Okay, here goes. The Jesus film. I want to start with a story. And this is maybe, we get monthly updates, email or regular mail. If you want to get on that, see us, and you can read these miracles for yourself. 3 or 4 years ago, lady has a vision, a dream about Jesus. That tells us she's Muslim. That happens internationally for decades. Dr. Bright talked about it. And it happens in America. I had it confirmed by a Persian pastor who used our facility in Orange County. He hears it all the time. God is reaching Muslims through dreams and visions. So, she wakes up and she wants to know more about Jesus. Very common. Often when we show the Jesus film, they'll shout out, "That's the man of my dream." Whoa. How did God know that actor would, you know, the Lord, huh? So, she's walking to work. She wants to know more about Jesus. And she looks down, and there's a Jesus film DVD on the sidewalk. One of our tactics. Overseas, you leave them anywhere. People grab these things. She can't wait to get home and watch it. That night, of course. On the way up to her apartment building, she invites 3 or 4 families. They all come to watch the movie. And when the movie's over, everyone present prays to receive Jesus. That, we estimate, you know, Melody and I, we have the best job in the world. We get to talk to people like Barry and Sharon and minister to them, and they're our best friends. Our ministry partners are the salt of the earth. And sometimes, you know, you'll be talking to, say, a widow, and, oh, I wish I could give more. Well, here's an example. I'm encouraging you, okay, what we can do with a little, and God turns it into a lot. We send out some of these newsletters, and maybe the appeal is for DVDs, because that's used overseas. It costs us $4.50 to send this overseas, okay? Let's say you're thinking, well, gosh, I want to invest in those, but I don't even have $50. All I've got is $45. You can finance 10 of these. And we estimate each DVD reaches 17 people. You've just reached 170 people overseas that are hungry for the gospel. Huh? God can take whatever we have and multiply it a bazillion times over. Change lives for eternity. So that's a story to open. On a recent email, just in the last couple of months, this granddaughter's concerned about her grandma. I guess she was religious and she spoke Portuguese and wasn't sure she had that relationship with Jesus. And so she got grandma to watch a Portuguese Jesus film. And when it's over, grandma says, I get it. Okay? Dr. Bill Bright, founder of Campus Crusade for Christ, you've all heard of that organization, Change the World. That's the umbrella under which are some 30 ministries, family life, military ministries, the campus ministry, how it started on college campuses, the Jesus Film, which is the largest ministry under the Campus Crusade umbrella. Campus Crusade, also known as CRU here in America, that's the nickname on colleges. So he founded that, and Dr. Bright had a vision about a movie about Jesus. And long story short, a Hollywood producer got together and produced the film. However, unlike a lot of stuff out of Hollywood, the script is the Gospel of Luke, so it's accurate. So, the movie was in our theaters in 1979, in American theaters, and today, we just checked. When we left home, it was in 1,317 translations. This morning, it's in 1,321 translations worldwide. And we praise God for that. It's a unique gift to the body of Christ. The leadership of Campus Crusade and the Jesus Film recognize that. That's why we work with hundreds of organizational partners. Wycliffe, when they go out there and do a translation, the first book of the Bible they translate is Luke, so we can make the movie. Good partners, the Church of the Nazarene Baptists, on and on and on and on, right? So many, many partners. We work with them because we recognize it's a gift to the body of Christ. We can't do it alone. 80% of the Jesus film is beyond the boundaries of Campus Crusade for Christ. That tells me we're only doing 20% of it. The partners are doing the rest of the job. Very exciting. Our director of organizational partnerships, Bill Wolf, very exciting guy. I call him a database on caffeine. I love to listen to him. He's so exciting. And he said, he asked one of our partners, well, what makes a Jesus film unique? And the partner said, oh, it's oral. People that can't read can hear the story. It's visual. You live in a culture, you don't know what an ox pulling a cart is, there it is on the screen. It's the Gospel of Luke, it's the Word of God, and the magic occurs, it's in their heart language. The language they learn on mama's knee, and Jesus is speaking that language. So, praise the Lord. I'm going to close with a story in an update. This goes back to June of 14. It's about a year old. You know, some of these just stick in your mind when you read them. Film team goes out in a rough area to show the Jesus film. And afterwards, the people had many questions. And they're doing their best. And gosh, it's getting late. We got to break down the equipment. We'll come back in a day or two and answer more of your questions. So the team's breaking down the equipment, and they look over, and just down the street, this group of people is in a circle. And there's some kind of a meeting going on, and so one of them walks over there, and they're talking to somebody in the center of the circle, but there's nobody there. Hey, who are you talking to? Can't you see him? It's the man in white, the man in the movie. He's telling us to follow him, and he'll take the darkness out of our lives. We document all these stories. We don't print anything unless it's accurate, okay? But Jesus makes a personal appearance. And you know, I can understand this. I was an assistant pastor, so I ran the church. I took care of all the nuts and bolts. And I can just see Jesus saying, you know what? Go break the equipment down. I'll handle this myself. Oh, lots of stories like that. So if you want to get on a mailing update or an email update, just we got a little form for that. And we also make the Jesus film, Magdalena, Released from Shame, the story of Jesus for children. I've even got the Pope endorsed this film. We've got a little sleeve there with the Pope's endorsement on it for Catholic people. So those are available. We make those available at our cost for $4. We're not making any money on this. And with that, I think I'm going to invite Melody up for the last word. Thank you.
It's so nice to be here with you folks. It's just a great church, and love the pastor, and the music was awesome this morning. Anyway, we're excited to be able to share some encouraging stories. It's like a cold drink of water on a hot day, and hearing from, you know, good news from a distant land. And with the Jesus film, it's, you know, 35 years old. But in the last 35 years, over 200 million people have come to faith in Jesus. That equates to about every 5.5 seconds someone makes a decision to follow Jesus watching the Jesus film. And Mark talked a little bit about our partnerships. It's a wonderful win-win situation. When the body of Christ is coming to the Jesus film and saying, we're working in areas that don't have the gospel and we need the Jesus film. Could you please translate it for us? And we have actually a database that has all the unreached people groups. And so we, you know, can work with the body of Christ, the missionary organizations that want to go into unreached people groups. And when, once there is funding and a group of people that have boots on the ground that are going to be working with the people there, and it's 50,000 speakers and above, then we will put it on the list to be funded and done. And because I think the body of Christ is seeing an urgency, they are ramping up the studio. The last couple of years, we've added people, and we are just really accelerating our language production, because we have we were doing all languages of 100,000 speakers, and so we decided to go down to 50,000 speakers. And at that time, there's 865 languages that needed to be translated of 50,000 speakers and above. So we call that Mission 865, and one of our donors got went around and asked some of his friends to help with this this goal. And he was able to collect $16 million so that every translation could be matched. So instead of $38,000 for translation, it's only $19,000 for translation of those 865. We're about down to 700 that is, we want to finish by 2020 or two, okay. So we're we've got lots to do, and we've got so many different people that are using the Jesus film. In fact, the Church of the Nazarene, one of our favorite partners, and they just love the Jesus film. We give them the equipment, we give them the film, and just say, we just want to know where you're showing it, and we want to know how many people came and how many decisions were made for Jesus. And that was their ticket for the equipment. And so we can keep track of where the coverage is happening. And so the Nazarenes go, well, with the Jesus film, we used to fish with hook and line. With the Jesus film, it's like fishing with dynamite. And they have planted over 26,000 churches themselves, just the Nazarene church. And, you know, the Baptists and the Assemblies and all the other churches that are, that aren't a cult, we will work with. Because, you know, they can cover areas that we can't. I mean, we can only have so much money for film teams, and we have a bunch of film teams as well that we fund, that we pay for their salary. But, you know, God is in the business of reaching people. And recently, the horrible atrocities going on in the Middle East, we've been hearing stories of people, especially in refugee camps, that have suffered under radicalism, have told our workers, we want to know about Jesus now. and he's seeing incredible eagerness, or they are. We have people over there in areas that have had to leave their homes, and they see the brutality, and they don't want to have anything to do with it. So see, in the horrible situation, God will open a door, and we are using the Jesus film extensively in the refugee camps, and of course we did in Haiti. I want to get you guys a Haitian Creole Jesus film to take down there, because when they were living in camps, we would go down there and do humanitarian work during the day and show the Jesus film at night. And there's something about an earthquake that shakes people up. And you know, because you've seen it, they are burning their fetishes and idols, and they're starting to really see that God is God, and he's more powerful. And let me see what, I was just going to quickly tell you that, you know, with 1,321 translations, we're getting into some unreached people groups that have never heard the gospel before. And it's just really exciting knowing that this is the last days and God is just using this to fulfill the Great Commission. And even online, people from over 220 countries have watched the Jesus film online. And 2.5 years ago, we got a digital media app that's free to download. And it kind of blew our team away because they said there's been over 25 million people watch the Jesus film just on our Jesus film app. And it's free, so we've got cards back there to show you how to get to it and put it on your smartphone or Android. So there's just a lot of different strategies, and God's doing the work, and we're just kind of helping water. The film that's not working is a premiere of Ethiopia. And what's exciting about it is these people, there's 4,500 people showed up that had really never seen a film, much less knew anything about Jesus. And the openness and hunger would blow your mind because people are just crying and responding, and the gospel is getting, they are understanding it because it's in their language. And such a revival broke out after that film showing that we actually caught on tape. They have had to, a group has gone in there from the United States that has helped the church build, they've trained pastors and they've built many, many churches, and now this Gamo people are reaching out to 17 other people groups just as a result of that one film showing some 3 or 4 years ago. So God is just really working through the Jesus film, and we appreciate the opportunity to share with you. We want to encourage you, and just keep up the good work as a church. We love your mission's heart. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Amen.
Well, Mark and Melody have discs in the back, and I think they're available for $4.50 a piece, $4 a piece. And again, 2 years ago, I believe it was, right, we raised money to help support and to translate a Jesus film into a unreached people group language, and I don't remember how much we raised exactly, but we raised a good portion of it. And the goal, again, is to get out in areas so that the gospel is preached in languages where people can understand something they've never understood before. They've never heard the message of Christ before in many of these areas, and that's what Mark and Melody are part of. And quite honestly, any way that we can be part of it, I think, is a great thing. So let's pray over them. And you know, we're actually going to go downstairs. We go downstairs for lunch. I think we could flop that DVD into a video player downstairs, and we can maybe see it downstairs where it's far less technically challenging for some of us. It's just a CD player downstairs, so we can show that thing during lunch. But let's just pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness towards us. We thank you for the Jesus Film Project that's going on. I thank you for Mark and Melody and their lives. God, they have They have donated, they're given their time and their efforts and their energy towards this. God, we pray that the gospel will be continued. Lord, there are people who are coming to Christ every 5 seconds because of something like this, and we don't see that on CNN. You don't see that on ABC or NBC. What we see is a bunch of trash, but the gospel is going forward. So, God, we pray that you would continue to make ways for the gospel to go forward, and, Lord, help us to be a part of that process. We ask you to just bless this Jesus film project. Has been going on for many, many years. God, we pray that you'd continue to bring workers and continue to bring in the resources to fund this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to set up a basket downstairs. Oftentimes, we will set up a basket so that you can kind of maybe pay for your lunch, and that's going to go towards something. Well, whatever you give towards lunch today is going to go towards the Jesus project and towards Mark and Melody. So we're just going to have that set up downstairs, and you can... If you were going to go to Hardee's and pay for $10 for lunch, you can maybe pay $10 downstairs or $20 downstairs, and maybe somebody's going to get saved out of it. Amen? Amen. God bless you. Have a great day, and avail yourself of the videos back there as well.
Have a good day today. Thanks for joining us for today's broadcast. You're also invited to join us in person Sunday mornings at 10:30 a.m. Viewers like you help to make this program possible. If you'd like to help, send your tax-deductible contributions to the address on your screen or give online at cfcdl.org. Thank you. If you enjoy this program, we'd love to hear from you. Comments can be sent to us online or write to us at the address on your screen. Thanks again for joining us. See you next week.